Hey everyone, Michael Antonovich with Swap Moto Live. The Monster Energy Supercross Championship continues its end of season push with the 2024 Philadelphia Supercross. The series' first ever visit to Lincoln Financial Field is an afternoon race, and the competitive title fights in both divisions will be showcased with the primetime slot on NBC. 101 riders are on the entry list for round 15, with 53 in the 250 East region and 48 in the 450 class. Although Nashville's crashes were vicious, the long season has seen few serious injuries, and a few potential frontrunners are returning to action today for the final weeks or to stay sharp for the start of Pro Motocross. Saturday's early start time prompted a few tweaks to the weekend schedule, including a Friday evening track walk and riders meeting. A dry week in Pennsylvania gave Dirtworks plenty of time to shape and develop the material that was dumped on the floor. And from what we've seen and what riders have said, the rocky clay is typical for this part of the East Coast. Expect it to be heavy from watering in the morning, but hard and slick during the main events. The unique shape of Lincoln Financial Field is reflected in the track's design, and there are noticeable kinks in the long lanes around the perimeter of the stadium. As always, here's how the top 10 are ranked going into the weekend. Tom Yell's at the top of the 250 East region with 136 points. Hayden Deegan is second with 123, Cameron McAdoo third with 120, Pierce Brown fourth with 116, Cody Schock fifth with 105, Max Anstey sixth with 94, Jaleek Swole seventh with 89, Daxton Vinnick eighth with 88, Chance Hymus eighth with 84, and Henry Miller 10th with 74. Jet Lawrence continues to lead the 450 class with 286 points. Cooper Webb is second with 281, Eli Tomac third with 253, Chase Sexton fourth with 246, Jason Anderson fifth with 224, Ken Roczen sixth with 223, Aaron Plessinger seventh with 198, Justin Cooper eighth with 177, Justin Barsha ninth with 166, and Hunter Lawrence 10th with 163. I missed press day, got a flight delay. So how was it after doing some laps? Because it's first time here, so a lot of questions.
Yeah, I mean, my first time in Philly. Yeah, I thought it was going to be cold. So, yeah, showed up. Feels pretty good out. Sun's out, nice and sunny. It's been a while since we've had a round where it was nice and sunny out. So it's good. Dirt's a little bit funky, but I think tomorrow will be good. Track layout's a bit different, but... yeah, just looking forward to a dry race.
Okay, I heard about this dirt. It's got like some metallic sparkle on it. Did you notice that when you were riding? I haven't been inside yet, but I heard that it's like, it's some different dirt.
Yeah, it's different. It almost feels like a West Coast round, like the way the track is. But yeah, I don't know. I mean, it's all new to me. I've never been here. New stadium, new dirt. New state, everything for me. I've never been here, so I'm just taking it all in and, yeah, having fun with it.
Well, I mean, you've been to PA before because you won High Point, so.
Oh, yeah, I always think like, because we're so close to, yeah, but, yeah, I mean, I guess I've been here before.
All right, hey, good job last week. Second highest East Coast guy. How was the showdown? Good to finally see where you stack up against everybody?
Yeah, it was good. I mean, I don't know. It was a realm where I felt like I was more so riding like myself. Still not completely riding like how I am in the practice track, which almost gives me more confidence, because when that guy does show up, I feel like I'll be in a really, really good spot. But yeah, P2 on the night when it comes down to East Coast, and P5 overall on the night. Yeah, I mean, felt good. Ran fourth for pretty much the whole race, but yeah, Smitty got me there at the end. But it is what it is. It's been a fun process, and I'm looking forward to just getting better and better. Sucks to have my best, or it doesn't suck, but it shows that I could have better results with my own coast, and you know, to do it with two coasts there is it means a lot, because there's a, you know, the field is stacked. But yeah, I just got to get good starts and stack these good results on my coast.
Okay, last thing. As the season winds down, you got two races. This is the last traditional main event. Then you have the showdown. And I was looking where you're at in points today, and it's a good little battle. There's some guys that you can make some ground up on, but there's some guys you're trying to stay clear of. How much is that a motivation at this point in the year, or is it just I need to get my best individual result just to cap it?
The positions you want to be in at the end of the year is 1, 2, or 3. So I don't really care when it comes down to the points. I kind of just want to stack good races just because I want to stack good races. I do feel like, you know, other than Foxborough, that was just not a good round. I didn't ride very good, just flat, sick, whatever. But if I take away Arlington, where I had that run-in with Max and was out for that round in no points, and the bike malfunction, or not the bike malfunction, but the GPS sensor malfunction in, where was that? Indy. I think, yeah, Indy. Because I was fourth overall on the night going into that last Triple Crown, and I had that bike issue. So take away those two races and say, put me where I've kind of been, which sixth place. Say I just got six for two rounds, I would be well in the points, well within that top five. So yeah, I've dealt with a lot of stuff this season, and to still be somewhat in the mix in the points, it's cool. But yeah, if we give me those two races back, I feel like we'd be in a really good spot right now.
Thanks, Julie.
Yeah.
Definitely didn't want to miss this one. I was after Foxborough, I was pretty a little worried. I was like, man, if I miss Philly, I'm gonna be bummed. But luckily just took last weekend off, and still bummed to miss that one too. East-West showdown, always look forward to those. But I think it was the right call. Just the shoulder was a little bit too weak for to race. I tried riding the Thursday before Nashville, and it just simply just wasn't strong enough, really. But I rode 2 days this week, felt really good, or a lot better than rode again today at press day, and we're good to go, solid. And back here in Philly, or well, first time for all of us back here in Philly, and just excited to be close to home. Grew up like an hour from here, and have a lot of family and friends coming, so that's going to be really exciting. And yeah, my grandpa's coming, never been to a race before, so yeah, it's pretty cool. So he's excited, everyone's excited.
That's cool, Seth. Like, enjoy it, because the home races, I mean, I'm not a racer, but I had St. Louis a couple weeks ago, and you have everybody that's around, and you want to see them and all, and you're just like, this is super fun, but you have a job to do. But I mean, you got a good reason. Grandpa's first race,
yeah.
That's cool.
Oh, dude, yeah, I'm so excited, and it's like, I mean, ever since they put this on the calendar, I've been excited, but then, like, this week, I was like, all right, like, here, it's time, and yeah, I talked to him every week, and he was like, man, I hope I make it till then, because he's, like, 91, and he's just joking around, but he's like, I'm just hoping I make it, and here we are, so he's ready to come, and yeah, just, you get all the good vibes, like, when you come have a local race like this, and gives you a little bit extra of extra boost of confidence and energy to go out there and get the job done. But like you said, I mean, it's another race, and you know, I have a job to do, but it makes it more fun when my family and friends are here.
Okay, so you rode press day. How was it? There's a lot of questions about, like, how's the dirt? How's the stadium? But as a local, how is it?
Yeah, so as far as, like, the stadium, I feel like it's, the floor feels bigger to me than a lot of stadiums. Not by much, but, like, just a little bit. And then, like, the dirt, right away it reminded me of Salt Lake City dirt. Has a lot of stones that, like, pebbles in it, it feels like, or like I've seen them, and like kind of feels that way, because it kind of seems like if the corners get dry, they're not going to get rutted. Today they had them pretty wet, and there were some good ruts, but yeah, then there's also like some hard slick stuff out there, so I don't know. It's gonna be a challenging racetrack for sure. It's gonna get those slick spots for sure. But I think it'll be come the night show once everything's worked in. Press day, it kind of takes the transitions a little bit to work in the berms and stuff like that. But by tomorrow, I think it'll be good, and they'll get some water in it tonight.
Okay, last thing. I've been asking guys this question over the last few weeks, and it's good to hear everybody's opinion of it because you see different body types and different ages, different motorcycles, all of that. When you were growing up and even now, who did you model your riding style after? Like, oh, I like the way that guy does this, or I want to do this way.
Yeah, that's a great question. I would say for me, it was like Ryan Dungey a little bit. I always tried to, I mean, his riding style I looked after, and just the way he kind of carried himself. And I thought, like, his consistency, like he just put himself in good positions when he needed to, and it paid off for him. And I would say that was the guy that I kind of watched the most. But it's funny because growing up, it's like I've never had a riding trainer, riding coach, or whatever you want to call it. It's like everything I've learned is from either watching or just riding on my own. And it's like, because even now when I do like training schools and stuff, sometimes I have trouble like teaching the kids because I'm like, I've never had someone teach. Yeah, and I'm like, I don't get it because I'm like, yeah, just do it. But like, it's not like I understand it's not like that. But it's like for me, I just kind of taught myself everything. And I watched a ton of stuff like growing up. And I feel like I just tried to, I was fortunate to have a turn track at my house. So I could just, even if I rode for 10 minutes one day, like I just parked in the garage afterwards. It didn't have to load up and go anywhere. And I just rode all the time. So.
Okay, dude, that's actually, let me ask you one more then, because this kind of goes hand in hand with that. How do you identify something that you want to do or change or perfect, and then when you want to go implement it, what's that process like?
Yeah, so like for me, I would like be, say, watching a Supercross or an outdoor, and I'd be like, man, like that was cool what he did. Like I'm pretty good about like picking up on things or like seeing what they're doing, even if I didn't do it yet or if I can't do it. But then I would go out and I'd be like, all right, like I'd pick a section on my track. Or like I would build like a similar section because I had like a little tractor and I enjoy working on the track too. And then I'd be like, all right, like try to build it similar. And then I wouldn't even ride laps. I would just do that section and just like try and work on it, you know, and like put what I felt like I saw into my riding style and see if it worked out. You know, like no one would be there telling me if it worked out or not. I rode by myself so much, but yeah, that's kind of the way I went about it. Honestly, like I would say till I was like 17 or 18, I rode in my backyard, like before I went to any training facility or anywhere. It was pretty crazy. It's cool.
Brad, thanks, Seth. Have a good weekend, bud.
Yeah.
All right, Marty. I'm here every weekend. I'm hanging out. I really pay attention to the bikes, and I know you guys are finding the tents and the horsepower here and there, and it's a lot you're doing after all of your years of racing experience. So how's it been to put on a different hat and learn bike development in this way?
Thank you, Michael. I mean, it's been really a pleasure to be working on this team. We've come a long ways. A lot of people really, some people know, some people don't know, but we started in a one-car garage. Literally, it was Jordan Smith's, and now we're here racing, and I believe we are very competitive. I believe we are just as good as a factory team, and, you know, the reason why I'm confident saying that is because I've ridden a lot of these bikes, you know, and I do believe that we have a great package, and I'm really proud of it. We are a small team. Yarif has given us the opportunity to kind of take hands-on on this, and he has given me the trust to just kind of do it my way. And yeah, it's been endless hours. It's good to see the bike up front. It's good to see the bike perform the way it has been doing it. Max has done really good for us. We're very, very proud of how far we have come with him. But yeah, we always go back and, you know, I'm a guy that, you know, and throughout my whole career, I've always liked to be the underdog. To me, it's I get more pleasure out of trying to compete, you know, be competitive and being there with the factories than already have the factory bike. You know, this teams have all the budget in the world, and you know they've done it for a long time. So, yeah, we're sitting here, two rounds to go for the 253 for the 450, and I feel like we've achieved a lot this year.
When you're finding parts, like I can look at them and I can see some stuff that is out there that like you're not finding in the motorsport.com catalog or anything like that. How do you find that stuff?
Well, for us, I'm going to be honest with you. There's a lot in that motorcycle, especially the 250, that is handmade. It is a unique bike. Really, people have no idea what we've done just from building a specific wire harness for it. We've moved the ECU to the front of the bike, just kind of like an old version of an older bike, and how we've rerouted stuff, and just to make it really convenient and special for us mostly. But it's just for experience, knowing people, and I like to hear a lot of what people say and learn and watch what other bikes have, you know. And we go on Monday, we sit down, and we go through what we need to do to become just a 1% better, because these 250s, the window of horsepower is to a certain extent, you know. You cannot, it's not like a 450 that you just can keep climbing and make it unrideable. The 250 is, how can you make this bike, you know, work in different ways that the other bikes are not working? And that's what I've been focusing on. It is honestly that it's so satisfying seeing the bike. I pay attention a lot. Like I said, Max is an extremely talented rider, but I really do believe that with our bike and our program and how we are handling things, we have helped Max become the best version of himself. So yeah, I'm proud of that. Finding parts and just, you know, I'm always looking at what's to come, you know, thinking of 2025, what are we going to do different? And we have a lot of things coming up, so we're very excited.
Okay, you've spent so much time in your career with Mitch and everybody in Mitch's team, and then Rockstar Husky and Scuba and all of that stuff. And I mean, I could only think as a teenager when you came here from Ecuador and you move and you like, okay, I could ride a motorcycle this way. What point did you really figure out the limits that you can take a motorcycle, that it's not just how it comes out of the dealership? Like, you guys can do whatever with it if you put your mind to it.
That is right, but it takes a lot of patience. It's a puzzle. These motorcycles, sometimes you can imagine something and the bike does not like it at all. And sometimes, you know, now I'm sitting on the dyno and you see a lot of the things that are happening and you translate it to the track and the bike is just not, or the rider doesn't like it, you know. And it is crazy to see, because I kind of go back to my career. The guys used to tell me this and that, and the dyno said that, and then I rode it and I was kind of confused. But it is crazy, because sometimes I've seen it. Sometimes things that are shown on the dyno, we've blind tested these riders and they choose what the dyno didn't, you know, the part that the dyno didn't, you know, just agree upon, or the other, that the part that we thought the dyno was better, it just didn't translate to the track. So it is, it's been challenging for us. Like I said, I believe the Honda has been a puzzle that a lot of people have been trying to put together. We are very, very close to having that last piece. Unfortunately, obviously the season's almost over for us, but we are very encouraging for 2025. You know, I really do believe that with all the experience that we have now on this bike, we can have a head start coming into next year. And, you know, new goals for us, new opportunities, new challenges. Me, I'm not a rider anymore. I set myself some goals. I set goals for the team, and you know, for us is to continue to develop, not as a team, a bond in between all of us, but whatever rider comes across, you know, they'll come to this team and really, really appreciate what we're doing. And I'm going to tell you something really satisfying for me and rewarding. Mitch Payton actually called me last night, and we were talking. And, you know, he told me that we're doing a really good job. He's watched the bike and told me the bike is really good. So it's, you know, that is really refreshing here for somebody with so much knowledge. And I respect Mitch so much. I mean, God, I rode for him and it was my dream. And it was an awesome conversation I had with him.
That's so cool, Martin, because that respect and that idea and all that Mitch knows and what you're trying to do now in a similar way was what made me think of why I wanted to come talk to you. And then to think that Mitch called you 24 hours ago is amazing, you know, and you guys get to discuss that. But don't say that you're not a rider anymore, because I hear you're doing some like tennis shoes and shorts practice starts down at the farm.
Well, you know, sometimes you have to go back and kind of put your helmet on, or, you know, for me, sometimes I get aggravated, you know, and I have a lot of passion under my skin. People know that. And, you know, I'm like, give me that bike, you know, let me see what you're really feeling. But yes, it's gotten to that point. I'm really going to involve I did a lot of testing prior to the season. Then obviously Max, we were struggling a little bit with the stars, and I tested for 2 weeks, and we brought the bike. We basically modified the bike for a different approach. We told Max, you know, trust us a little bit, and we've made a better turn on that, and he's happy with it. We're happy with it. But I think I need to be a little more involved. My plan for this summer is I'm going to start riding a little bit outdoors, because everybody makes fun of me. I have a little bit of a beer belly, or we can call it a dad bud. And I can still go fast. I can feel the motorcycle. I feel the handling, and I feel the motor, but I like to be a little more involved. So I'm really looking forward to that. And yeah, looking forward to the future. We have the big boss this weekend here. Yariv came to see us, seeing how the program is working and communicating with all our sponsors. So our goal is just to continue to grow, continue to have people that believe in us. Hopefully we can continue to impress everybody else. And most likely, what I keep telling everybody, my goal is the window of opportunity on a factory team is very slim, but I want to be the next team. I want to be the team that really, you know, Max will tell you, we really work with the riders, and that is something that I believe we're creating something special. And yeah, we'll just continue to be better.
I bet if you got on the bike tomorrow, got in like session one, you could still be like on the scoring pylon, like top five. You know, you could put a heater down.
I'm confident I can, you know, if I can get a fresher track, I believe, just because I'm so out of shape.
Yeah, unseated group. Yeah, yeah.
Unseated group, and I believe I still, I don't want to sound arrogant, I really don't, but I still believe I can throw a heater, man. I mean, like I tell people, I will black out to make sure I qualify on the board.
Okay, last thing. It's really fun to learn so much. I've learned so much in my years in the sport, because I came into it one way, thinking my preconceived notions of how racing goes and how motorcycles run. And from all the experience and all the knowledge that you guys in the pits have given me, I see that it's not the way that I came in. For you, are you of the belief that the motorcycle can only be perfect in this one way, or it can always be different? Because, you know, if you change one thing, another thing changes. Like, could you explain to people at home what it's like to really set one of these things up?
Well, you know, it's actually a very good question. And unfortunately, unless you're winning, you know, you're never going to think the bike is bad. You know, if you're winning, why are you trying to change the bike? But testing, well, as an athlete, you know, I'm going to put myself as an athlete. You know, if you're winning, you really are not thinking about what you can improve. When you're not winning, or, you know, you're struggling, you're always working on your technique. Well, I feel like on this other side of the fence, I just feel like there's absolutely, I mean, you can never be satisfied, you know? I mean, if the rider is satisfied, I believe it's a good sign. But me as a team manager, and, you know, my involvement with the engine program and everything else, we're always looking for more. Like, we're, you know, Max qualified first, and people are thinking, well, why are you still changing the bike? Why not? I wanted to be better, you know. I wanted to be really good, you know. And that's one of my goals, you know. Like, I just don't want to settle. It's one of those things that, even though I never won a championship, I was really, really close. People can talk all they want to talk about it, but as I told Mitch yesterday, I said, man, I was fast. I crashed. I didn't care. But I was a contender every time somebody signed me. And that's what I want to be on this team. My goal is to hire these athletes, to mold them, to really make them understand really kind of how I want to do things, and really work with them to, so we can accommodate their riding style and this motorcycle. I mean, I'll be honest. I never rode a Honda on my professional career. I've ridden this, and I'm so pleased with it. The chassis is unbelievable. And I feel like that makes things a lot easier when I truly, with all the testing that I've done, I really believe we have a chassis that is great. So we can obviously, it'll accommodate any rider to a good standard.
Thanks, Martin.
Thank you.
Off.
Twisted T-Dub.
Yeah.
All right, Chiz. This is my first year going to all 17 Supercross races, and I know that's like not that big of a deal, but oh my God, is it hard? Because you have to be on it every weekend, and I watch what you guys do. It's gnarly. How hard is it, really?
It is tough. Like, honestly, just the travel. I mean, so you obviously see it. You know, obviously, but you do 17, it's like just the, like, the travel over and over wears on you, I think, more than anything. Like, riding during the week, when we're not racing, I just ride more during the week, right? So, like, it's the same riding-wise. Like, I ride 2 or 3 days during the week and then race on the weekend. Or if you don't race, we ride 3 or 4 days during the week. So it's like riding and training is almost the same. It's just the travel. It's the flying and the, you know, driving to the airport and parking and checking in and security and getting on the plane and off the plane and rental car and hotel, unpacking and packing and all that. So that's what kind of just wears on you. But when you've done it a long time, you kind of get in a little routine and you little tricks of the trade and make things easy on you. But yeah, that's the tough part, is just the travel wears on you a little bit.
Okay, is it just me, or is this a universal feeling when we get to this point in the year, like around 12 through 17? The Monday through Friday feels like it's in fast forward. Like, they feel like they fly by.
Yeah, it does. I mean, to me, really, it does start a little slow, but then, yeah, it just gets faster and faster, I think, as you go. Because you kind of get into a groove, at least I do. Kind of get in a groove, and, like, you get in a routine of, okay, this day I take off, I ride this day, I train this day, I leave this day, and you kind of get that routine going. So, and then, yeah, before you know it, you're like, wait, this is round 15 or whatever already. So, yeah, it's crazy how quick it goes by. And then, you know, we have a week off, and then we're right into outdoors. And then nowadays, we're right into playoff races and all that stuff. So we raced a lot last year with the World Supercross as well. And, man, I feel like I said this at Anaheim 1, I feel like we never really had an off season. We just kind of just haven't stopped racing. So, yeah, definitely have to learn to manage, like I said, manage the training and the manage your output, like your training, your riding, just all that stuff. Because you don't, these days with all the racing that we do and not much time off, you got to focus on recovery, you know, just as much as your training.
I read this article the other day for baseball players, especially if you're a position player, you want to be there for every single game. And to do the 180, 183 is a big mark of an accomplishment, because you don't want to miss one. And you know, as a guy that wants to do 17 main events and 11 outdoor nationals and 3 playoff races, it's a nice feeling to get to the finish line and know, okay, I did it, at least I could. If I didn't make every main event, at least I was there and at least I tried.
Yeah, for sure. Like, you don't get any better sitting on the couch at home, obviously, right? So the sport's always evolving and getting better, and younger guys coming up. And yeah, the more you can be here and put in the reps at the race, you know, you can do 1,000 laps at home and practice during the week and train and all this stuff, but none of it matters until you get that 20, you know, 10 minutes in practice and a 6-minute heat race and a 20-minute main event. So that's when it matters, you know, all that stuff, all the work, what it's all done for. So yeah, being here week in and week out is a big accomplishment, first of all. There's so much practice and training and testing, not to mention the qualifying and the practice laps at the race and the gate drops, the qualifying races, the heat races and stuff. So yeah, just to get far into the season is a tough thing on its own. But the more you can do that, the more you can keep showing up and being here and racing, it helps you to keep, if you have an open mind, you can keep learning. And that's honestly what I love about it. I feel like you're always learning something. And like I said, there's always younger guys coming up. And for me, being an older guy, you're always just trying to get better. And like, well, what's that guy doing? What's Jet doing? You know, what can I learn and what can I apply and go back home and work on and apply it and come next Saturday and try to get better again.
All right. To kind of put the bow on this one, you mentioned all the racing you guys did last year from Outdoor Nationals, World Supercross, playoffs. How much racing are you doing for the rest of the year?
The plan is to do at least most of the outdoors. Obviously, I want to qualify for the playoffs. So it's a little bit weird because, like, even my contract, it was a different plan going into it because we didn't even know about playoff stuff yet. This World Supercross stuff has completely changed from what we thought schedule-wise, like what it was originally going to be. And we're still kind of learning what this year is going to be. So, yeah, for me, the plan is, and what we know is that World Supercross is not supposed to conflict at all with any of the U.S. stuff. So the plan is to pretty much race all the races, do most of the outdoors, if not all of them, whatever I need to do to qualify for the playoffs. And then, yeah, we'll do World Supercross, however that pans out later in the year. So a lot of racing, more racing here at the end, towards the end of my career than maybe at the beginning. But honestly, like I said, I've learned a lot doing this long time. And I know I can't do this forever, so I'm just, you know, taking it all in, enjoying it, enjoying being here at the races, and so trying to keep the train on the tracks and get to all the races.
Thanks, Kyle.
Yeah, thanks.